This is the moment I've waited for. I can hear my heart singing. Soon bells will be ringing.
I'd like to begin with prayer and invite the Lord to be a part of this ceremony. I know we can do it on our own, but I'd like the Lord to be here with us. Let's just pray together. Jesus, I love you. I thank you, Lord, for this opportunity that we have to bask in your presence. And Lord, your very first miracle was at a wedding when you turned the water into wine. We know you like weddings. This is marriage is your idea. We want to honor you today, and we ask that your presence be here for Brother Robert and Chona. Let them remember this occasion the rest of their lives and cherish the moment. We ask for your anointing, Lord, to quicken our hearts, to say the right thing, to be a blessing, Lord, to this wonderful couple. And everyone say in Jesus' name. We're just really honored today. Robert was telling me he was coming down the aisle, how honored he was to have me do his wedding, and I'm actually the one that feels the honor, and we're all excited to be a part of this and share in one of the happiest moments of the two of his lives. And a wedding, in my mind, can be one of the happiest and holiest moments in your entire lives together. And so, we're gathered here to witness and celebrate the marriage of Robert Lester and Chona. Marriage was designed by God for several reasons. I'll just talk about one of them, and that's to defeat loneliness. Someone said that the two most important days in your life is the day you were born, obviously, wouldn't be here, and secondly, the day you figure out why. I see a lot of people aimlessly staggering through life, and they haven't figured out what their purpose is, and they try different things here and there, and normally have bad results. But when God made Adam, he obviously recognized, it was in his plan, he recognized that he needed a partner. Everybody else had a partner but him. So I'm sure he was really surprised when he woke up and saw the beautiful lady that God had made him. And Reverend Wayne Huntley said recently that if he had a feminine bone in his body, God took it out when he made Eve. And he made her so very beautiful after he put him in a deep sleep. But he said it's not good. After he made everything that he made, he always said it's good. It's good. It's just repeated over and over and over in Genesis, first few chapters. It was good. It was good. It was good. Then after he made men, he said, very good. After he made Adam. And then he said, but it's not good for a man to be by himself. And I know some people seem to do really, really well by themselves. I marvel at how well they do. I'm just not cut out for that myself. I've been married a total of 39 years, and I highly recommend it. And I get more done myself personally, because that's how God created me. I get more done being married than I would if I was single. And because I'm just one of those kind of guys. I need someone. I need to have a partner. And my sweet wife is here today somewhere. There she is. She's my rock and my blessing. And I just celebrated our 15th wedding anniversary. Last Thursday, I took her to the zoo to see some of my relatives. And we had a good time. And it was great. Anyway, someone said life doesn't consist only in the number of breaths that we breathe, but the number of the moments that take our breath away. I don't know when you two met. I'd like to have been a fly on the wall to see just how the chemistry happened, but when Brother Robert walked in here that Sunday. I am the evangelism pastor here, so I always notice guests. That's part of my job. And I didn't catch him coming in, but I did notice him in the pew, and he's kind of sitting on the edge of his seat. He wasn't just sitting back like most people do, like you're doing. He was on the edge of his seat. And we were standing. I was just observing his, as I observe all of our guests, and I noticed that he was wiping tears. He just kept doing this over and over. And I thought, boy, he's really feeling God for the first time. This is really, really awesome. And at the church, he told me, well, I've been away from God for about 13 years. And I said, we got to get together and have a hamburger. I want to get more acquainted with him because I loved his spirit right away. And so he took off for Longhorn. He didn't tell me where he was going. I felt we were headed out back, and I got in the car. My wife had changed the plans due to some circumstances, so we just wound up at Longhorn, and big long table, about 8 or 10 of us. And all of a sudden, someone tapped me on the shoulder. It was Brother Robert. He was in the table right there eating by himself. So, of course, we just welcomed him over, and we got really acquainted. He entertained us with his life story, and he told us about you, John. I'm really nosy, so I just ask him, are you married? Have you been married? How many kids you got? How old are they? Where are they at? And I just ask about 50, 11 questions. And that's 61 questions. I asked a bunch of questions, didn't I, by the
way? Yes.
And so that he got real excited about, he was hoping that he could get you to marry him. He would be excited about that. He told me how smart you were, John. How just awesome you are. When he laid eyes on you, he really had a great excitement about you, and he said we just was best friends for a long time, and he said now that I've come to the Lord, I would like for her to be in my life. And so that was, you know, that was the conversation the first Sunday. And so
we said you're Filipino. I just figured you were beautiful because most of you are. Years ago, in my early 20s, I preached revival for this church, and one lady got the Holy Ghost, and she was Filipino, and she's still here today. Her name is Letty Howe. She's as beautiful as ever. And my brother's marrying a Filipino. Her name is May. And there's two other men in this church that's marrying ladies from that country. So I don't know what God's doing, but he's putting lots of you all right here, comes Filipino, right here in our church, you know, to help us do the work. But anyway, someone else also said life is not measured by the number of years in your life, but measured by the life in your years.
You guys aren't 21 anymore, but God can make it so that at 47 and 42, you can make up for lost time and have a whole lot of life in the remaining years that you have left. And I just have a strong feeling that God has brought the two of you together, and you've already proven to me, Brother Barber, you've already proven to me what a tender man you are before the Lord. And you shared the story, in case all these folks don't know it, that when you landed in Kansas City, God just immediately began to deal with your heart to go back to church. Didn't even know where to go, called your former home church in Alexandria, and they sent you here. They made a wise choice by doing that, because God knew we needed you here.
And you have something that's missing here. The Bible says, well, one member lacks, another member supplieth. And you told my brother, I was trying to get him a job at your company, that me and you were already best friends. And I thought, well, how wonderful a statement. And I said, I actually feel that way.
I actually said bosom buddies.
Bosom buddies?
Bosom buddies.
Bosom buddies.
Yeah, that was another term.
Bosom buddies. I like that. And I feel that way. I really like to have known you for a long, long time. We have kindred spirit. And then you've already proven to me how smart you are, Chona, not by what you could do out there, but the very first time you heard the gospel message in such a way that you could respond to it, you did the first time. And God baptized you with his spirit the first time you were here. And that says so much to me that your intellectual IQ is very, very high. Because when God dealt with you, you didn't put him off. You just said, I feel that, I'm responding to that. And here you are. And so we welcome you to the Life Church. We're really thrilled. Some people that I talk to, they're not really intellectually honest. When I bring the gospel to them, they reject it. They're not smart people. Smart people accept the gospel. And so God is, I just feel as much in God's will for you two getting married as anybody of the 41 marriages. I've done 42 here the last
14 plus years in this church, and I'm always honored to do it. Let me give you some free advice. They say that you may marry the one you love. And my advice, I read from someone and I share with you, is to love the one you marry. It's full. You guys are already best friends, I can tell. A funny statement I read says someone, marriage is like a deck of cards. When you start out, all you need is two hearts and a diamond. And at the end of 50 years, you wish you had a club and a spade. But you guys would be 97 and 92, so I don't know if you would need those.
Love doesn't keep score, someone said. I think that's a good way to live. The scripture says that God designed and created marriage as a good thing. It's a beautiful, priceless gift. Beautiful, priceless gift. And God wants us to get used to it down here. It's why he designed it, so that as he is the bridegroom, we are the bride of Christ. And we get in that bride called the church by taking on his name in water baptism. So we're looking forward down the road to baptizing you very soon. In fact, I had water prepared for you last night, Chona, but you didn't make it back from Branson. So we'll keep it warm. So we're looking forward to you taking on the name of Jesus, like today you're losing your natural name, your maiden name, and you're taking on Lester for the rest of your days. And I know you'll carry it proudly. So when you get baptized in Jesus' name, you take on the name of your bridegroom. So when he comes back and the trumpet blows to get his church out of here, it's those that's been called by his name that he's coming for, the Bible says. Okay? And that's looking for him. So that will complete your new birth, and that's going to be a beautiful day. So the Lord prepares us for that great day in the sky by calling us out of, you know, whatever church we're born into. The Lord started one church. I tell people this every day. The Lord started one church 2,000 years ago in the book of Acts with 12 men called the 12 apostles, like there's 12 of us here today. That's what he started with. He spent 3.5 years with them. And he says, okay, guys, I'm leaving you. I want you to go back to Jerusalem, go to the upper room. I'm going to send my spirit back. I'm not going to leave you without me. I'm not going to leave you comfortless. I'm going to send back the comforter, which is my spirit. And so they went back, and 10 days later, the Holy Spirit fell on them in Acts chapter 2, as well as several others, about 120 in the upper room. And they all received the baptism of the Holy Ghost at the same time, speaking in tongues. I've seen thousands get the Holy Ghost speaking in tongues in my 63 years and 42 years of ministry. And on video, I've seen 50,000 get it at a time in Ethiopia. It's just amazing. And there was a revival in the Philippines recently where my brother's fiance got the Holy Ghost. I saw them on the video where 1,000 got the Holy Ghost in one service. So God's pouring out his spirit all over the earth. And so from that church, he told the apostles to go and build his church. He called it my church. He took ownership because he bought that church with his own blood. And now, here we are, not just 1,000 years later, but 2,000, almost 2,000 years. The church was born in 30 AD, so here we are, 2018. In 2030, it'll be 2,000 years exactly. And guess how many churches there are in the world right now? 34,000. That's insanity. 34,000. But the Lord started one, now we have all these choices. And most of them are man-made dogmas and doctrines of men that's really not going to count for much when the Lord comes back for his bride. I'm proud that even though you were out of the church for a while, Robert, you never lost your faith. You never lost your love for the truth. You didn't join up with something less. You stayed true to your beliefs, and that says so much about you, Les, Brother Lester. And when you were introduced to it, you accepted it as well. And the book says in Revelation chapter 18 verse 4, to come out of her, my people. So there's, God has people in all these churches that they get really sincere in their prayer life and start seeking God. And as God puts that curiosity in their heart, they begin to seek the word and search the scriptures to find out what the truth is, because there's only one church in the Bible. And it's very, very plain how to get in that church. So we're real proud that you're coming that way. You guys are both, and Robert, you and Sean are embarking on an incredible journey, and only God knows. I'm excited about it. Actually, only God knows what you two will become together. Who knows where your lives together will take you, what challenges and blessings will befall you.
where the winding road of Providence will carry. I hope he leaves you in Kansas City until he comes, but I can't know that for sure because, Robert, you've been everywhere. But women, enjoy you while you're here. And a marriage is a journey between two people who have wholeheartedly committed to building a life together. And this has come together quick, but in the same sense, you guys have been becoming best friends for about 8 years. So I'm excited about that.
No looking back, no regrets, full steam ahead. In one sense, if the lifetime of your marriage was like constructing a building, you're breaking ground today. And I want to challenge both of you to become great marriage builders starting today. And I have books I will share with you. I didn't have one, and I brought and give it to you today. I'm going to have my wife order it. It's called Sacred Marriage. It's the best book ever written on marriage. I wish every married couple would read it. It's about how most people get married to get happy, but even though it's a part of it, really what marriage is about is for us to become holy. Because when you get married, all of your flaws are exposed to someone very close to you, and you have to deal with them. You can't hide them anymore. And you put yourself in a very vulnerable position, and your mate will help you to become closer to God. So I want to challenge you today to allow me to give you those gifts. I have some awesome tapes as well. They're about 85 minutes each. And I'm going to record those for you and give them to you. It's called Love and Respect. And we men have to have respect, and you ladies have to have love. And it's just 85 minutes of pure fun to listen to, excitement. You'll laugh and cry. All right. Ephesians chapter 5, probably good if I read the scripture, 21 says, honor Christ by submitting. I hear a lot of weddings where, just a woman submitting. I like this verse. My wife likes this verse. Ephesians 5:21 says, honor Christ by submitting to each other. Did you know that was in the Bible? Submitting to each other. So I submit to my wife. She's right 99% of the time. She's very, very thoughtful. She has the same thing about thinking about it, praying about it. And most of the time I've learned to really, really listen. She's really sharp, and she hears the voice of God. So I'm learning. As I get older, I'm learning to submit to the will of God as she speaks it, and I recognize it. So it says, you wives must submit to your husband's leadership in the same way you submit to the Lord, for a husband is in charge of the wife in the same way Christ is in charge of the body of the church. He gave his very life to take care of it and to be its savior. So you wives must willingly obey your husbands in everything, just as the church obeys Christ. And you husbands, show the same kind of love to your wives as Christ showed to the church when he died for her, to make her holy and clean, washed by baptism and God's word, so that he can give her to himself as a glorious church without a single spot or wrinkle or any other blemish, being holy and without a single fault. That is how husbands should treat their wives, loving them as part of themselves. Probably one of the hardest passages of scripture in the Bible is for me to love my wife as Christ loved the church. Man, he died for the church. I can see myself, if I needed to, laying down my life for my wife. But this is a daily thing. I need to love her as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. For since a man and his wife are now one, a man is really doing himself a favor and loving himself when he loves his wife. No one hates his own body, but lovingly cares for it, just as Christ cares for his body, the church, of which we are part. That the husband and wife are one body is proven by the scripture, which says, a man must leave his father and mother when he marries, so he can be perfectly joined to his wife, and the two shall be one. I know this is hard to understand, Paul said, but it is an illustration of the way we are parts of the body of Christ. The last scripture, so again I say, a man must love his wife as part of himself, and the wife must see to it that she deeply respects her husband, obeying, praising, and honoring him. And I could really make that easy for my wife if I would love her as Christ loved the church. She would have no problem, verse 33, if I could be my heart. And I truly want to do that as I celebrate my love for her.
All right, I think this would be a good time for... the two of you to think. face each other, and let's hear that song that you'd like for us to hear. We're entering into the now the most binding and sacred moment of the wedding ceremony. So that's why I've asked you to join each other and hold hands. You're about to take are an expression of the love and commitment that you have for each other. As you state these vows to each other, remember that you're not merely making a pledge, but you're committing your lives to each other before God and this company of witnesses, promising to fulfill them faithfully in everyday life. Robert, would you please repeat after me? This is your favorite part. I, Robert, take thee, Chona.
I, Robert, take thee, Chona.
Whom I hold by the hand.
Whom I hold by the hand.
To be my lawfully wedded wife.
To be my lawfully wedded wife.
To live together.
To live together.
After God's holy ordinance.
After God's holy ordinance.
In the holy state of matrimony.
In the holy state of matrimony.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For rich or for poor.
For rich or for poor.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and cherish.
To love and cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
That we may become one.
That we may become one.
In spirit.
In spirit.
One in mind.
One in mind.
One in affection.
One in affection.
And above all things.
And above all things.
One in Christ.
One in Christ.
And can you say I do?
Oh, I do.
I do all
this. I do all this.
I'm trying to find a way to get that in there. You have to say, I do in a wedding, right? Chona, you get to repeat the same thing. That sound good? I, Chona, take thee, Robert.
I, Chona, take thee, Robert.
To be my lawfully wedded husband.
To be my lawfully wedded husband.
To live together.
To live together.
After God's.
After God's.
Holy ordinance.
Holy ordinance.
In the holy state.
In the holy state.
A matrimony.
Of matrimony.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poor.
For richer or poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
That we may become.
That we may become.
One in spirit.
One in spirit.
One in mind.
One in mind.
One in affection.
One in affection.
And above all things.
And above all things.
One in Christ.
One in Christ.
I do.
I do.
Beautiful. All right, do we have rings? Thank you, buddy. Mm-hmm. That's one. We have another.
Oh, yeah, there's two.
There's two of them. Oh, they're twins. All right. A wedding ring is a symbol of a never-ending circle of love, commitment, and devotion. It communicates this message to each other every time you see it or you feel it on your finger. I have something very special on my finger. Those of you that know my story, I've been married twice. And my first marriage, we had a missionary come through and I didn't have anything else to give, so my wife and I just gave our wedding bands and the offering. I don't know how much they got out of them. I know I paid a whole lot more probably than they got out of them, but it came from our heart. So we didn't have any wedding bands. So one day my father that I was co-pastoring with in the pulpit said, in the middle of this sermon, I don't know if his mom planned it or not, but he called me up to the pulpit podium, and he said, "I want to give you this ring, son." It was his way. Too small for his finger. "So I want to give you this wedding band as a never-ending reminder of Mother and I's never-ending love for you, son." It was a very touching, tender moment. So I put it on my finger, and I rarely take it off. So I told my wife, when we got married, "You don't need to buy me a wedding band, because I'm wearing this one. It's my dad's wedding band, just like yours." So I was at a prayer meeting. You'll love this, Brother Robert. I was at a prayer meeting in another state, and Sister Mangum was heading up this prayer meeting. She was speaking, actually. And when she got done, she asked us, you know, to come around the front and grab someone's hand and pray with them about what she talked about. You know, greater commitment to the Lord. This is early morning prayer. There's probably 50 of us there. So she's coming down those steps, Sister Magnum, Sister Vesta. She had high heels on. It was about 20 steps. I just stepped up there to help her down the steps. This has been a few years ago. She was elderly then. She's probably 90 now.
Yeah.
And so I helped her down, and so she just grabbed my hand. And Sister Penny grabbed my other hand. So I had these two powerful women of God on both sides of me with another woman or two. So I'm standing there, the only man in this circle, feeling really honored to be between these two prophetess ladies. And we got ahead and prayed, and Sister Mangum looked right at me on mornings. "Your ring is anointed." I said, "What do you mean?" She said, "It's like it's on fire in my hand." Hmm. I just fell on my knees, knowing that there's no way she could have known my dad gave me that ring in an anointed testimony service. I'm real proud to wear it. Reminds me of my dad and mom's love. And that's what a ring is really all about. But your ring's also send a message to everyone around you, a message that you've been spoken for, especially as pretty as you are. You've been spoken for. That you belong to Robert, and that you are emotionally and spiritually and physically bound to your spouse who might not be present with you at the time. That's what a ring really stands for. So Robert, make sure I get this right and get the right one here. Would you have your vows to Chona seal further by the gift of this ring?
Yes.
And would you now place that ring on Chona's finger and repeat after me? Chona.
Chona.
This ring.
I give to you.
As a pure symbol.
Of my commitment.
May you wear it with joy. May you never doubt. My devotion. May you always.
Be inspired.
By my love. With this ring. I take you as my wife. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Very good, sweetheart. You can do the same thing. Chona. Would you have your vows to Robert sealed further by the gift of the ring? Yes.
Yes, I
do. Would you please repeat after me? Robert. This ring I give to you. As a pure symbol of my commitment. May you wear it with joy. May you never doubt. My devotion. May you always be inspired.
By my love.
And with this ring.
I take you.
As my husband.
In the name of the Lord Jesus.
I really feel the Lord in this wedding. I like to feel the Lord when I'm doing well. Something special about you two. You just didn't come together by accident. With all the people and 7.5 billion people in the world, God brought you two together. He saw every tear. Robert, I know your story. I don't know yours, honey, very well. I know a little bit. He's told me a little bit. You've had some tears too. And God has stored your tears in a bottle. And sometimes we just suffer. And the Bible says that the Lord learned obedience by the things that he suffered. We don't really learn anything unless we're suffering. I've never seen a preacher preach yet that was worth listening to that hadn't suffered in his life. And so God lets us go through things so we can become more like him. And of all the people he could have picked, he picked you for each other. He saw all the tears for all those years that you suffered, asking God why. Sometimes it's easier for us to live with the questions than the answers. But God, he's wise. And when we can't understand his ways, we just learn to understand his heart, and he brings it all together. And he puts it together perfectly. And I just feel so strong about you two. I'd like for all of you to stand with me. In fact, I'd like for you all to come around. It's just a small group of us. I'd like for you all to come around. You men, come over here on Robert's side. Just come in close. And all of you ladies, come and gather around. You'll stay right there. And I want to pray for him. I want you to pray for her. You men, lay your hands on Robert here. He's your pal. He's your buddy. He's your brother. Isn't this neat? We can do this in a small setting. Now I'm going to lay hands on him. Let's just ask God to bless them richly in his name. Jesus, we lay hands, Lord, upon this couple right now. Lord, you brought together by your divine providence and your divine will. In the name that's above every name, in the name of Jesus, the majestic name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for putting this couple together, for bringing them to the kingdom for such a time as this. Here we are, Lord, in Kansas City, Missouri. Thank you, Lord, for your divine providence by bringing Robert to our church. And let him fall in love, Lord, with this lovely lady, Chona. In the name of Jesus, Lord, let your will be wrought every single day. Let it be unveiled in their lives. Let them go forth to advance your kingdom together. Let them have a great time, Lord, walking in holiness. And let the joys of the Spirit, of your Spirit, Lord, and the fruits of your Spirit be manifest in their lives. And may the gifts of your Spirit operate through them, Lord, in the days that we have ahead, Lord, to do something special for you. And to bring as many people to the kingdom as we can, Lord, before you come back to catch us away. In Jesus' name, we ask you to bless them bountifully, Lord, in their wealth and in their health.
Yes.
Use them in a great and mighty way. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. For as much as Robert Lester and Chona have pledged their faithfulness each to the other in the company of these witnesses, and whereas they have sealed their vows further by the giving and receiving of a ring, by the authority invested in me by the Lord Jesus Christ as a minister of the gospel, and by the state of Missouri, I pronounce that they are husband and wife. Robert, you may kiss your beautiful bride. Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce to you for the very first time, Mr. and Mrs. Robert Lester. Yay. This has been
Okay. Oh my gosh, this is like so good already. We haven't even ate it.
Yeah, most of it.
Oh, wow. I can't put that in a bag.
Then
Dad,
just
the small ones will fit in the bag.
Yep. Oh, I supposed to dashed it into her face.
No. But you can do it to him.
But we can't do it.
We just cut that.
Yeah, we
down.
Do yeah. Eat each other.
No, she'll break.
Do your arms. You gotta entwine your arms.
Yeah, you gotta intertwine.
Yeah. Like champagne.
Yes.
Like
there you go.
Yeah, okay. Ready?
You gotta open up.
Wait a minute. I gotta feed you. You gotta feed me, right?
Oh.
Go.
Oh.